This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
And we are on the hit back. I want to welcome you to the show. It's another beautiful Thursday afternoon. It's March 17th, Thursday. I understand it's St. Patrick's Day. So I want to say to you, if you are listening to the show, my name is Keyshell Davis, and I am excited to be here for another Thursday afternoon on the hit back. If you are listening, of course, at work, and you are waiting for that 5 o'clock hour, you are almost there. Almost there. Do a couple more things and you'll be ready to get off, but don't turn that dial. If you're already on the road, again, you are probably sitting in traffic or about to head into traffic, don't turn that dial. And if you work for yourself like me, you probably have lots of things going on your plate on today. And still, same thing, do not turn that dial. Today's topic is really one that I am excited to talk about because I am looking forward to learning. As you know, I've said, being a host of this show or just filling in for this show from the very beginning, I call this show a grow show, right? So yes, we can talk, but it's all geared towards helping you learn something, do something, and grow. And today's show, I'm excited because I truly believe that I will grow. And I am excited to soon introduce my guests. I'll give a few minutes before I do that. But today's show, I am calling Inside the Industry. So we are going to take a deep look inside the industry with someone who I believe is so qualified to talk about the industry that we're going to talk about. Now, you might say, okay, what industry am I talking about, Keyshell? That industry is the oil and gas industry, right? So, of course, we know it's been in the forefront of talks locally and globally more than ever, I believe, recently. Of course, we've always talked about prices of gas and you know, oil, but specifically with what's going on in Russia and Ukraine, it's come back up again. And so today, again, we're going to take a deeper look. I have the guest who I am so excited to have the conversation with from in this, I guess, this forum. He is who I consider an industry great. His name is Ethan Moss. He is the founder of JML Enterprises and the head of multiple gas station locations in the Bahamas. So he definitely has a lot that he can share on this topic. And during the show, we will dive in on the industry itself, like, you know, what's going on with these gas prices? How are they determined? What do they really affect? We're going to dive into those questions, of course. But more importantly, I also want to dive into the heart and mind of the mover and shaker behind, or at least one of the mover and shakers behind the industry, and that's Ethan Moss. And of course, the goal of this show is to keep you informed with what's going on in this industry currently, but also to inspire you on the journey, because I have the privilege of knowing him in a variety of capacities. And I know we can talk gas because that's the hot topic of, you know, what's on everyone's minds and mouths But, you know, I really want the show to perhaps be much more than that. So if you have ever complained about the high gas prices, if you have wondered about the how the petroleum industry works in the Bahamas or just around the world, and really just wonder about how the gas prices, how the industry affects other areas of your life, this show is for you. And speaking of, you know, complaints, there's not only complaints that I see or talks. There's a lot of memes going about as it relates to this gas industry as well. Sometimes I was scanning Facebook, I think earlier this morning. I don't know if the Facebook, you know, Facebook, y'all could read minds, right? Or, you know, no, they could read minds. They could also read WhatsApp. And I think that's where it came from, because I ended up on Facebook this morning. And one of the first things that I saw was Viola Davis, of course, the actress. Viola Davis, and she was speaking about just the gas prices, and she was jumping on a horse, and that was her way of saying, you know, if the gas prices continue to go up, that's her going to be her new form of transportation. And of course I had a laugh, and now I realize that that's probably Facebook reading my WhatsApp messages, because, you know, I was talking about this topic for earlier this week. And so again, if you are someone who really want to dive deeper into this industry, this is a show for you. You can join in on the conversation. Of course, there are telephone lines. They are 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. The text line is 422-4796. 422-4796. So that's the text line. So I have an opening question for you. If you're listening, I want you to dive in. Of course, I see some of my people already coming in. Hey, hey, Rain. Hey, Charmaine. I see that you're online. What category do you fall in? So if you're a listener, text me or call. What category do you fall in? Do you fall in category A, which means do you watch the gas prices like a hawk? Like, you know when it's up one penny, and you know when it's down one penny, and you make your decisions based on the gas prices. Do you fall into that category? Or do you fall into B category, which says, I don't really watch nothing. I just pay. If it's $5 today, I can pay it. If it's $6 tomorrow, I can pay it. I know that I need gas. It ain't make no sense me trying to hurt up my head about something I cannot control. I'm just going to pay it and hope that gas gets me from point A to point B in a given week. And hopefully that time as I need gas again, I have the money. So those are the two categories. Feel free to text and call and let me know where you fall. I see Rain says A. Rain, I see your question. I'll ask a couple of moments. And so let me take a minute to introduce Mr. Moss. He is Mr. Ethan Moss. He is the president of JML Enterprises, a management and operations company primarily focused on the petroleum convenience retailing industry in the Bahamas. And he has 22 years in this role. He's a graduate of Queens College, College of the Bahamas, and the State University of New York. I see text messages already coming in. Great. He is an accountant by profession, a kingdom businessman active in ministry. He has been married to Teresa. Now, Ethan, I pulled this offline, so if it's more than that, let me know. But from what I've seen online, he's been married to the fabulous Teresa Moxie for 23 years. And they have two boys, Ethan the second and Edward. And I've also had the privilege of working with Ethan in my business, the Training Authority, as a client. So he's been a client of mine for so many years. I would classify him also as a mentor and a go-to person for me when I need to challenge my thinking, when I need to expand my thinking on any topic. I just, you know, the first person I typically think about is Ethan. And so Ethan, you know, I am so privileged. It took a while to get you here because your schedule is full, but I am happy that we are here. Ethan, are you there?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear. So I'm going to dive. Before I ask the first question, I want to get this text message because I see, you know, I feel that this is going to be a very hot show, and I'm going to get the text messages that came in, and then we're going to have a really good conversation. Great show as usual. If gas prices go any higher, which I expect it to go, I think by summer it might surpass $7. Anyone catching ride with me, I charge in $30. And also our light bill summertime, I think everyone light will be off because BPL $1,500 light bill. He also, this texter continues, I am 100% sure I will not be sweethearting. Oh, Lord, look where you going. Oh, sweethearting because I ain't filling up my car. I need to be out of the car. Okay, so thank you, Texa. That was a really good opening question or opening comment. So, Ethan, I want to start with just giving some insight into, at least letting the audience know who may not know you and may not know your results, your track record in the country. Just share a little bit about how many locations you have, which you may not need to share the locations, but which brand of gas people, you know, nosy, they may want to know that. And then perhaps I think it's fair to say that you are leading one of the newest gas stations that have been developed and built into the country. Do you want to share a little bit about that before we go any further?
Keisha, thank you for having me. It's really a pleasure to be with you. And I'm not sure I'm that person that you spoke about at the beginning, but I'll do one thing at the very top. And
humility. My wife,
are you hearing me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, my wife is Teresa, and we've been married 25 years now.
I knew it was more than 23. I had a feeling.
Yeah, it's 25 now, and the mistake is often made in calling her Moxie, but she's, you know, she's really adamant that we say Moss.
Forgive me.
So, you know, I've had the wonderful privilege of being involved in the petroleum industry in the Bahamas for 22 years. And it's by the grace of God and a lot of people who have helped to make it happen, including my colleagues who I work with. And many Bahamians don't understand the industry, but are impacted by it, as you've said, and as your writers are in, those who are texting in, ask those very tough questions. So it's an industry that I would say right off the top, and this is perhaps the number one thing that most people don't know. In the Bahamas, it's regulated by the government of the Bahamas. Okay. And so in getting in a number of years ago, I've seen it go through some very interesting developments. And also what I've seen is some very tragic things as well. Because good, strong business people, perhaps not fully appreciating the regulation in the industry, have not fared well. So my introduction to it, and just stop me when you want me to answer something else, but my introduction to the industry really came as a matter of searching for a way to augment my income at the time. And in that search and asking questions and ran across what used to be the Texaco brand back then, it's now the Rubis brand, and really met some wonderful people in the industry who I have the greatest regard for. Many of them still around, having done this 40 years, I mean, imagine some are pretty close to 50 years. And I've seen some wonderful people come in the industry since I've been involved. So It can be a rewarding industry. It is a very difficult industry. One, because it's regulated tightly, and two, because it's impacted by everything that happens outside of our control. So whatever happens globally as it relates to the fuel industry in the Bahamas, and it's not unique to us, but it because we're so small as a country, we really get some significant dents in your business model as time goes on. So, yeah, I think you got my bio pretty much tied down. I'm The only thing I've allowed is I'm the proud alumni of College of the Bahamas and also Queens College. So, you know, I'm Bahamian rooted and born.
Born, bred, as they say, born, bred, and gadad.
Bahamian. That's me.
I see a comment came through. Trust me, I know all of his gas station locations because they are the only ones I patronize. I am the same way, Texas Charmaine. I am definitely the same way. My car will be on E, and my husband, no, I'm telling the truth. Because I stay getting row with money in my pocket, passing the gas station, bend the car on E, because I know there's only a couple of gas station locations that I'm going to, and if it ain't over there, I'm going to take the chance. That's just me. Some people might call that irresponsible, but, you know, I know which gas station locations that I typically want to support. So, Charmaine, I totally can relate to that. So, Ethan, you said a couple of great things, even in your introduction. You said many don't understand it but are impacted by it, and we're going to talk about that. And it's also regulated by the government. And you also mentioned that it is a difficult industry. And again, before we get into the details of the industry, I hate this term for me, but I'm going to use it because it came to my mind. I want to pick your brain a little bit as the person behind the industry for a minute. You started with one. I think now you have about 6, 7. I could be wrong.
Well, let's put it this way. We have grown our footprint over the years at VPNN and had the privilege to be a franchisor, a management company, partnering with a number of the locations that we have oversight for. Mm-hmm. And so what is always important to me is not the number. What's important to me is the impact that we're having on those who we serve as customers, those mm-hmm. who serve the customers, and that's our team members, and how we help the industry to be better
yes.
Than we met it when we found it. Because the... I often say, you know, we could see plenty vehicles at a gas station and we could conclude that the gas station is making plenty of money.
Mm-hmm.
The reality is activity does not translate into plenty of money, as people would think.
Mm-hmm.
And as we get into it, I'll explain what that means.
Yes.
But yeah, we've been very blessed to grow over the years. We've been very blessed to have partners come along and say, hey, would you assist us in helping to make this gas station business that we're involved with work, and we're very happy to do so because that's our model.
Mm-hmm.
We've modeled ourselves to make sure that we can be support for help in the industry, and by the grace of God, I'll be very clear about that. And some great people who kind of understand what it is that they're trying to do, we've been able to grow our footprint over the years.
Yeah, and I love that, and it alludes to the question that I was getting at when I started with, you know, the number, and that is, what is it about the industry that you enjoy? Because, you know, to be in an industry for 22 years, you have said in your introduction that it's not an easy industry. It's highly regulated. It's impacted by something, things that we have no control over. But you've not only stayed in the industry for so long, but you've also expanded and grown. So you started to allude to it when you talk about impact and mission, but what is it that does it for you, that makes you want, and I'm going to use a term that I learned from you, Ethan, that makes you want to smell the gas every day, all day, for so long? What is it about you that you love about this industry?
People.
Mm.
We have the wonderful opportunity to prepare individuals who come to work in the industry at our locations. We have the wonderful opportunity to help to reshape their thinking about life, work, business. And my greatest fulfillment, I'll give an example. The current public relations voice for the Bahamas Petroleum Retailers Association.
Mm-hmm.
I met him 22 years ago as a young man, and he's done some wonderful things and is now representing the industry at that level
mm-hmm.
in the public relations area. he's a young man that grew up in Market Street, and pumped gas as a young boy.
Wow.
And today, you know, his two daughters came into my office a couple of days ago, and I looked at them and I remember when he was just a young man and full of energy. And actually, he taught me a bit about the industry, and now he's doing some wonderful things in the community as a whole. So that, to me, is the story of Jamel on the platform of distributing petroleum products and convenience store items. So for Jamel, it's about being able to map the journey of those who come to work in the industry, whether they stay with us for 2 days, 6 months, 10 years, it doesn't matter. So I say to people all the time that, yes, I sell gasoline, and yes, I sell diesel, and yes, I sell all the products you can find at a gasoline station. And those things are the impetus for us to invest and reinvest in our community through the people we serve.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been really the real secret to our success over the years.
Wow. I hear the music. We're going to go to the break in a second. I just want to reiterate a text. People, wow, this is the factor that so many of us use as a reason to flee in the opposite direction. So I'm happy that you said that we're going to pick this conversation up after the break. I think we are just diving in, and we'll see you after the break.
Fantastic.
King Nassau is taking spice to new heights with the new Baja Whopper and Baja Crispy Chicken sandwiches. Enjoy your choice of a flame-grilled Whopper or a crispy chicken filet topped with chipotle sauce, guacamole, jalapenos, cheese, lettuce, and tomato, all on a fresh potato bun. The new Baja sandwiches at Burger King Nassau pack plenty of flavor, and with an ice-cold Pepsi and fries or onion rings, it's the perfect way to fill your day. The Baja Whopper and Baja Crispy Chicken sandwich are only available at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
When I got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live at Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number. They see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. It's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic. Your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
KB and Sting, coming with the Mahibin Ting. Come on. Woo!
Hairy bone and bread, I don't want to live nowhere else, even when I dead. Eyes a bohemian, and I always late. If you want me there by 9, better tell me come 8. See, eyes a bohemian, and I don't like say, nobody gonna spend my money when I go to my grave. Yes, eyes a bohemian, don't want make no fuss. But if you we know, but outside tell it, you will wanna us. Like I'm just grabbing though.
How Bahamians go, how Bahamians go. I love that song, KB. So we have a public service announcement. Just want to take a moment to do this. So COVID-19 vaccine campaign. COVID-19 vaccines and boosters are now available at the South Beach Clinic on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. On Wednesday at Flamingo Gardens Clinic from 1 to 5 p.m. Elizabeth Estates Clinic from 3 to 6 p.m. and Fleming streets from 4 to 6 p.m. and at the Marathon Mall, Monday to Saturday, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Visit vax.gov.bs to book an appointment or simply walk into any other of our locations. And it's so ironic, you know, I read that because, you know, COVID, while the pandemic is still here and COVID is still a topic, I was reading an article in Forbes about how rising energy prices will affect the next vacation. And anyone knows me, y'all know I love to travel. So my eyes went straight to this article. And it talked about how, and they had stats, and I probably won't look for the stats right now, but the gist of what they were saying, a part of in the article was, the decisions about canceling or deciding to go on vacation had less to do about COVID now and more to do about the high prices of the plane tickets, et cetera, which is closely alluded to gas prices and energy prices rising. And so, you know, this again is one of those topics that are hot. And we have some questions that came in that are more industry specific. And I promise you, we're going to get to the industry in about two more minutes. But I wanted to pick up what you said, Ethan, about people. Because again, I want people to get not only the insight or information on the industry, but insights from you as someone who is, I call a mover and shaker. I know you are a man of humility. So I'll be the one to say it, not you. But you said something that was very powerful, that you said people has kept you into this industry, regardless of how difficult it was, regardless of how regulated it is, regardless of how much areas that you can necessarily control as a businessman. But people keeps you there. One might say that, you know, the people who work at the gas station, you know, pump the gas, they are not seen by society's standards as people who really want to be there, right? And so their service to, you know, their work may be, you know, lower standard, or they're just passing through. What would you say about that mindset in terms of how you look at your employees and what you see as the impact you are making with those who serve in that industry?
It's the business model that we've adopted here at JML is not one that is unique to us. I think what I've learned, and even in this industry, that business people really want to help and build the community. Mm-hmm. And quite often the restraints of business, the amount of money you have to reinvest, the experience in business where people take advantage and don't honor their commitment to work, it makes it tough. But I'll never forget a quote I heard, and I forgive me because I don't remember the author, but it goes this way. The CFO of a company said to the CEO of the company, CEO, what if we invest in the people who work for us and they leave us? The CEO, who I think he got this from me, but anyhow, he said back to the CFO, what if we don't invest and they stay?
Yes.
So I think because I am blessed, I am privileged, I am graced to be a part of something that it took blood, sweat, and tears for men and women to build over the years. And like I said before, a number of them are still here and they're still working and they're still pushing to make a difference, right? We found just a little niche to kind of focus our attention on. Mm-hmm. And in so doing, the reward for us has been fantastic. And when I say that, the reward, I don't want to allude to a monetary reward. I want to talk about the reward for a young man who comes in on his way to the police force, and he has to work, he's just out of school, et cetera. And typically they come to this industry because I need to find something to do. And so we take that young man or young lady, and we say to them, okay, please, Friday is important, and Friday is simply payday. But mm-hmm. for goodness sake, don't work for Friday, because Friday will run away from you the more you work for it. What you need to do is, while you are on that drive-in and that pump, what you need to do is practice how you greet customers Practice how you keep the surroundings clean. Practice, because these are the disciplines that will help you when you go on to the things that you want to do. And the practice is not to make you perfect at cleaning or customer service. It's to cause you to appreciate that when you become a peace officer, you have to speak to your audience, to somebody you may have to stop on the side of the road because they're in breach of the law, but you have to treat them as though they're human beings. And so we've tried our best. Keyshell and listening audience, it is not easy. But we've tried our best in the industry and certainly at JML to make sure that we are adding value to our community by helping to shape, to guide, and to develop the people who work in the industry. I know sometimes, because we get customer complaints, obviously, what industry doesn't get customer complaints? Mm-hmm. I know sometimes it doesn't, you know, we may not always do a good job at it. But, you know, I recall seeing a young man who was at a particular site, not one of the ones that I operate, and this young man was just fantastic at making me feel that it's okay to come and spend my hard-earned money before I got in the industry. And he was in the industry for a long time. So, you know, that's kind of the people focus for us. And I would dare add, I think that every one of the retailers that I know, whether I know them personally or being able to observe, while it's tough, we're really trying to build our community by helping as many people as we can.
I love that. We have a text message that says, sounds like Mr. Morse has a philosophy that if he invests time, money, and effort building people, they will in turn help to build his business. And I love the philosophy as a trainer. You know, I love that quote. I think you got that from Ethan. You know, but whoever said it, I am owning it. You are owning it. Whoever is owning it, because it's such a true statement. It's about investing in employees. And it really took me back to one of our initial meetings. And I had to do a quick search on my Evernote 2013, when you and I met to do some training. And one of the things that always stood out for me was, you didn't see your stations, your gas stations, as just gas stations. They were training centers. And, you know, for me, the training heart, you know, fell in love with that right away. And I think that's why you and I get along so well, because you believe in investing in the hearts, the minds, the skills of the people who serve in that industry.
You better believe it, Keyshell, and since we need to get you back, because there's still...
You know, that's my plug.
There's still some of my team members today, they're still with us, who they're very good at just the, what do you call it, the Excel and Word platforms, mm-hmm. just because of the sessions that you came and you did. And just to let you know, we've moved now, we've added training and development centers, because we found that training... needs then the environment of development as well. So yeah, we continue to push that agenda.
Yes. Thank you for that. So I'll be calling you. But I know, you know, you and I have a heart for training, and so I know with the new location now that's settled in, I'm pretty sure I'll be back. But let's dive into the industry now, because of course I could always continue on this train of, you know, getting people to understand who you are. And that's always exciting for me, the person behind the industry. But I have some questions that have already began to come in. And so I want to dive in because people want to know. And so question number one was, you know, and I love that it's so direct. What are some of the factors that affect the high price of gas? And just for the knowledge, and I'm one of those people who fall into the B category, I just pull up to the gas station and say I want X amount of gas. I don't look at prices, Ethan. I figure I need gas anyway. No matter how much it costs, I'm going to have to either suck my teeth and pay it, and just when I'm ready to go back, I have the money to go back. So that's how I fall. But for those who want to know, who follow the gas prices now are $5.52, $5.68, $5.50, according to today's Guardian. So what are some of those factors? We know what's happening in Europe, but how does it affect the high price of gas here? Give us that insider knowledge of the industry.
I'd be happy to. And again, let me just say right up front, I'm speaking as one of many business people who run gas stations or, mm-hmm. or service stations, as we've come to know them. And there's actually an association, the Bahamas Petroleum Retailers Association, and the president okay. and the vice president, the PR manager, they're really starting to ramp up getting this message out there that, number one, the gas station retailers, and by the way, the industry is huge. I'm really speaking about retail because that's where I'm focused. Mm-hmm. And there's the distribution or the wholesaling of it. And so you'll see the large oil companies. And I think there's three primary ones in New Providence and maybe a fourth in the country. There's the supply end, which is outside of the country. Okay. And that's where the impact on prices really starts outside of us. It's a macro policy that has micro impact, and the micro impact is personal. So I want your audience to understand that controlling fuel prices in the Bahamas is not an easy thing to do because it's macro supply that is globally supplied. And then the regulation begins at our borders. And just like every other product that comes into the country for the most part, there's duty on gasoline. There's also VAT on gasoline. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at a price of five, whatever it is, 52 or one of the things that your listening audience must understand that the first $1.06 at today's price plus an additional 50 cents at the day's price goes into the public treasury.
Okay.
The retailer's margin, and I'll speak to the retailer's margin, is 54 cents. So it doesn't matter whether a gallon of gasoline, when you go to your favorite location, is $8 a gallon or $1 a gallon. Currently, because of regulation, every retailer maxes out at 54 cents. The wholesalers have a fixed margin as well, so I don't want to be disingenuous to them. Mm-hmm. And so the pricing structure is a very involved one, and it's historical. I think it came out of many years ago, a formula that was determined as to how prices will be charged to the final consumer. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, and this is my personal commentary, that pricing structure has not moved with conditions in the country. I'm not sure I know what the reason is. What I do know is that the retailer has been earning 54 cents. And for a context, one of my colleagues likes to put that in perspective this way. If a price of a gallon of gasoline today is $55.52, mm-hmm. The retailer makes a 54 cents margin, if you think about this, that means at a gross margin rate, the retailer at gross margin now, not net.
I'm listening making, very closely. I heard you say gross.
is making 10% or just around 10%. I know of no other business that is able to only have a gross of about somewhere between 10 and 12%, just depending on the retail price.
Right.
It's dipped as low as 9% in the years that I've been in. The reality is, whether it's 9%, it's fixed at 54 cents.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, bread basket items in our country, the staples that the government I imagine preserves for those who are at the very bottom of the economic pool mm-hmm. can buy food like rice and flour, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Those things are margined at 23%. Gasoline is at 10% or fixed of 54 cents. And this has been the case now well over 10 years.
Wow.
So the cost of living and the cost of doing business is not factored into the margin that retailers are able to make.
Right.
And then, as I started off, to reinvest in the business and growing their business footprints and impact in the community. So that's what makes it very difficult. Now, My statements are not statements of fault, blame. I'm not trying to explain, you know, the rationale, et cetera. I'm just trying to state the facts as they are. Mm-hmm. As a retailer, and having to, especially in today's environment, manage cash flow so very, very, very carefully.
Yeah.
Again, the motoring public don't realize this, but you know, I'm sure we've seen those large tankers of gasoline delivering fuel to service stations. At today's price, you're paying somewhere around $45,000, maybe $46,000 for one of those truckloads of fuel. So imagine the retailer from their cash flow perspective having to find that kind of funding repeatedly several times a week, depending on the amount of deliveries. It is really a monumental task to keep pace with all that's happening in the community, with all that's happening in the industry.
Yeah.
The last thing I'd say about this part in terms of trying to deliver, to get to understand the inside of the industry. What happens when prices change, and this is whether it goes up or down, the retailer himself has no control over that. As a matter of fact, your listening audience should pay attention to the Guardian and the public, the dailies, because the prices of gasoline are published right in those papers whenever they change. And many people just kind of gloss over it. But you have a right to pull up to a gas station and say, hey, the price now make sure you get the official gazetted price.
Right, okay.
Because sometimes the trackers could be a little off. But the gazetted price, as published by the government of the Bahamas, is always available to you whenever the price changes, and so that you can hold us accountable as well. So I hope that kind of gives a little bit of an insight. And I think fundamentally what I want to communicate is it's a regulated industry. Retailers and wholesalers alike have fixed margins, both in gasoline and diesel. I'm sure that there's some explanation for it historically. But my own commentary would be that, and as the Bahamas Petroleum Retailers Association is currently doing, really trying to get the public to understand that we're going to have to buckle in for the long run, because as global prices trend the way they're trending, impacted by wars or rumors of wars or incidences where supply chains are interrupted, et cetera, just like everything else, fuel prices are going to go up. And it is really, really, really tough to manage it either from as a customer or consumer or even as somebody like myself who's retailing the product.
Yeah. Wow. That was helpful for me. You know, a couple of things that I jotted down, $45,000 to $46,000 per truck of fuel. And that's one or more times a week, depending, of course, I guess, on the demand. $1.6 per gallon goes to the public treasury, and then there's the 50 cents, all of that go to public treasury. There's a 54% fixed margin. So really, really
54
good.
54 cents.
54 cents. Sorry, look at me. changing 54 cents fixed margin. I think they were helpful because we had a text that came in that asked how much money does it take to operate the gas station. So when you look at those prices, and you said that you know the gross margin was roughly 9 to 12 based on what you've seen, that's not net, right? So give us some more insight, because that question came up as to, you know, someone who's looking and say, yeah boy, plenty of people who own gas stations or retail centers, they're making plenty of money, because like you say, the cars are there. But you, as the person who are inside the industry, those cars very rarely move you. Can you speak to that a little bit more?
I'll start with a little bit of humor. You know, I have many of my friends and family who complain about traffic, right?
Mm-hmm.
And every time they said that, I say, you're helping me to help a young man, a young woman stop complaining about traffic. It's like I need the repetitive business or the repeat business.
Mm-hmm.
Because the unit price of profitability, either the gross margin, and hopefully you can carve out some net profit, is very slim. And
wow.
So the the idea about trying to explain the 54 cents fixed gross profit per gallon, and diesel, I think it's 34 cents for retailers.
Wow.
The reason why it's important for the public to understand this is because we don't want them to think that we are price gouging.
Right.
We are not price gouging. And again, I'll just repeat this. It doesn't matter, based on the current legislation, it doesn't matter whether the price of a gallon of gasoline to the customer goes up to $6 or drops down to $3. The retailer currently simply makes 54 cents on that gallon. And out of that 54 cents, we are charged to do some very interesting things, like every business that operates in our country. We have to pay business license. And by the way, again, historically, business license, and it's the case right now, is charged on the price that the that the customer pays at the pump. So we pay and it's a preferential business license rate, but nonetheless, it is very easy to inflate your business license fee yearly, because if the price of gasoline rises and you pay business license on the gross sale amount, you're still selling the same gallon of gas that you always sold, but the price just overnight went up. You're now going to pay business license fees as a rate on that higher price.
Right. Wow.
If you don't understand this, you will have some serious cash flow issues. And even when you understand it, you could have some serious cash flow implications. And so I don't necessarily speak for my colleagues, because there are some varying views on it, but I think overwhelmingly, all we want the public to know is that it's not the retailer, the gasoline retailer, who is charging this price or moving the prices higher, or making tons of money because the poor people are suffering. Actually, we're all in this together.
Mm-hmm. We have a question that came in, and I want you to explain it. What does he mean by margin?
Brilliant question. Margin is what you have left after you paid for the fuel that you purchased and before you pay your expenses like electricity and salaries and wages and business license fees, etc. So if I sell you a gallon of gasoline for $5.52 today, and out of that $5.52, I keep 54 cents in order to cover the rest of my expenses. The difference between the 5.52 and the 54 cents is what I pay to the company that supplied the fuel, and what they then turn around and deduct their profit and pay back to the government for duty and VAT, and then what they pay the supplier to import it into the country. So gross profit is the initial money that you make after selling it, but before you pay your expenses. Mm-hmm. Not before you pay the add-on expenses, not the expense of buying the product. So if you bought a pencil for a dollar and you sold that pencil for $2, your gross profit is a dollar. Mm-hmm. And then you take that dollar and you pay for the things necessary to keep your business open. I hope that explains it.
Yes, and that's you know, the supplies you talked about, vendors, salaries, et cetera, all of that. And I see a text that came in, and that's just the numbers related to petroleum. That has nothing to do with supplies, as mentioned, sold in stations, nor salaries that need to be paid. Really, really interesting and insightful. I have another question that came in. What grade gas are we buying in the Bahamas? Because in the U.S., they have premium, unleaded, regular, and super premium. You want to talk about
okay.
that?
So Keisha, that's an industry question for the wholesaler. Okay. I believe, I mean, not that I shouldn't know, but we have, I think it's a single grade in our country, and it's a single grade suitable for all vehicles, so it's a very high grade.
Okay.
But I don't want to speak to it as a matter of fact because, to be honest, I don't know. But the oil companies, and again, they're all regulated. They're all connected to very scientific, very disciplined processes. And they're all in the business of repeat customers. And so the grades that come in, I can't, especially between various suppliers, but right. I am aware that it would be suitable, mostly so, not mostly, absolutely so, for the vehicles that we have in our country. If we have some requirements for special grades, then, you know, you can call one of the big oil companies and they'll be able to direct you in that regard. But as a retailer, we pretty much, and because we're franchised, we pretty much distribute the product that the supplier supplies to us.
Understood, understood. We have a follow-up text to the margin question. So is he saying that if the price goes up, he makes no extra profit? So who is making the money? that look like
absolutely. I again, to inform your listening audience, the retailer, if the price goes up, still makes the same 54 wow. cents. The retailer, if the price comes down, still makes the same 54 cents.
That's so, all you got to say. go on.
So the breakdown of the fuel, and again, it's I don't think there's anybody trying to gouge in the process. I'm going to be very clear about it. The pricing structure, I am sure, must have a rationale behind it. Right. And perhaps I can lend, I have my own personal view of what that rationale is. But I prefer somebody who knows the rationale behind the pricing structure to speak to it. And perhaps you could have somebody from the Ministry of Finance at some point to come on. And like I said, the Bahamas Petroleum Retailers Association, who I'm sure are listening, since that question has come about, will do their best to educate the audience.
Great, great.
But the fundamental thing that we must all be aware of is we do not produce oil or fuel or oil-based products in our country. So we import it. So because we are consumers that import, whatever the supply cost is, that is what's going to drive the cost all the way through the system.
All right. I think that's a powerful place to stop. It's 5 o'clock. Believe it or not, an hour has passed. So let's continue this conversation after the break. I will provide the text and telephone lines as well for you to contribute to this conversation. So we'll see you after the 5 o'clock break.
And I'm longing for your touch. Yes, I am. 'Cause I love you. I love you.
Ooh, baby, I love you.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This is a serious fella, man.
Don't sleep on him.
I ain't gonna sleep on him.
Seriously, don't sleep on this boy.
Yes, sir.
He ain't got no heart at all. And they say teeth from teeth, God smile. I believe.
My mommy tell me that before.
I think you believe in that.
Brand new phone?
Where?
Can't find that. Time now?
I just buy that.
Oh Lord, brand new television. New Jordans. Gone missing. This boy then sell my things.
Boy.
Cash for gold, got all my chains. Leave your things, shine them, that's a loss. Leave teeth, the Lord off the cross.
My
gal can't find her rings. We don't lie, but you know it's you, King.
Huh.
He just come out of jail last weekend. But he done been all over being. This boy then snort three lines.
What?
Make the punch like 15 times.
Oh.
No job, he rob instead. Then you good for nothing with the picky, yeah. Real talk and team so tough. Then thief up all my stuff. When they catch me done for good. Hold on, I think he has something in the bush.
Hey, boy.
I ain't saying the boy does thief.
That's what you think.
I just telling you all don't sleep.
Better not.
And I ain't saying the boy is fast.
Let me tell you.
I just telling you watch your
ass. Ask me about the boy walking up the hill with a full tank of gas on his shoulder. And you know something wrong with that. Yeah, the boy got issues.
Yes, sir.
And he does lie. And I know he does lie. And you know what your ma say.
Well, what she say?
A liar is a thief and a thief is a murderer.
That's real talk, Ronnie.
Amen to that.
Listen, I was so interested in listening to the song, I forgot. I was supposed to tell the producer already. I was getting into the song, forgive me. So today it is welcome back to the Hit Back. My name is Keisha L. Davis, and today's show, I think, is such an interesting one. I am really enjoying this conversation because I am personally learning a lot, and it's inside the industry. And the industry that we are inside today is oil and gas, and we have a very well-qualified person to speak to this topic, Mr. Ethan Moss. He is the founder of JML Enterprises, which is a management company that not regulates. Look at me putting you as the regulator, Ethan. But that serves...
Oh, my.
that's prophetic, perhaps. The industry... through several locations in the country. And we have such great conversations that are coming in, questions that are coming in. And so I have the opening question for those who are listening in. And that is, you know, what category do you fall in? Do you watch the gas prices like a hawk? Or do you B, just don't watch nothing, as we say, just pay the gas price? If you pull up to the gas station, whatever it is, you know you need gas, you got to pay. So that's the opening question. And then again, if I were to think through another quick, fun opening question, which type of driver are you? Are you the person who looks at the gas, their tank on E, and keep driving, thinking you can make it? Or are you those person, I see this, saw this meme somewhere on Facebook before, where your tank is on half, and you rush into the gas station. I want to hear from you. Let's make this, you know, it's an important conversation, but it's really a topic that there's so many memes that's out there. I'm definitely in that category of, and Ethan, this is so terrible, right? I get riled for it all the time. I have to be honest. I have money in my pocket, and I would pass the gas station thinking that I'm going to make it wherever I'm going. So,
well,
go ahead.
I would suggest keeping a gas container in your back trunk as well.
Well, you see, I won't do that. And I hear my husband in my mind all the time, oh, Lord, this gas, just car on E again. So
that, he must be on call all the time, because if that happens.
So my husband, he's like, you pass the gas station, you must see no why. You pass the gas station. So... I got to do better. I know. All right. So just for some interesting do you knows before we get back into the questions and the text. And so just before I give those, text lines 422-4796, telephone lines 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Please contribute to the conversation. I thought it was interesting as I was just doing some reading and research for today. Which country has the highest gas prices in the world? And this is as of March, March 12th, which was just a couple of days ago. Hong Kong has the highest fuel prices in the world, according to Global Petrol Prices. So you can go on globalpetrolprices.com and you can watch, you know, who this information, if it fascinates you. On average, motorists pay $10.71 per gallon. And it's followed by Norway, Denmark, and the lowest is Venezuela, interesting, which is 95 cents per gallon, which is followed by Libya and Iran. Very interesting as far as prices. So when we think we have it high, someone else, I would imagine, has it higher. And so let's get back to the questions that came in and comments. So we have a text that came in. Could you imagine how good it would be if we had a reliable, safe, unified, and regulated public transportation busing system? We should have less stress about gas. And Ethan, I want you to comment, but my thought process is it's still going to affect the prices of the buses because the buses rely on fuel as well. What say you?
From an operating perspective, and I believe I understand the person texting to talk about the how the busing system functions. But certainly from a cost perspective, diesel again in our country is a regulated commodity, and it is impacted by the things that happen outside of our country from the supply end, and then it's also impacted by the taxes when it comes into the country. So. Yes, you know, if the busing system is efficient, but it doesn't speak to the fare that you will pay, which will represent the cost of operating the busing system. So I would imagine it'd be less than operating a car if you had an efficient system and you could get up and down, but mm-hmm. you will, relatively speaking, still face prices that are high.
Yeah, I see some messages come in. Someone says, going to the gas station with the gas light on. Someone says, I have to get better at this. And we have another person says, quarter time, can they go into the gas station? Good for you. I try it, but I don't get there all the time. So we have another comment that came in. It seems to be, and this is a conversation from earlier about, you know, who's making the extra profit. It seems to be lunacy that if you sell gas, say, for $3 a gallon and make 54 cents a gallon and pay business license on the amount sold at $3, then have to turn around and pay business license on sales of gas at $5 on the same 54 cents a gallon. That cannot be what he is saying. Hold on, let's see. Can he please clarify that? Is that what you're saying?
You got it exactly right. That is the reality of our the regulation and the fuel pricing structure in the country. So, again, the retailer's margin is fixed. The regulators, the government of the country, they fixed the duty rate, they fixed the VAT rate, and they also fixed the margin for the wholesaler and the retailer in the price that you pay. And as long as that is the regulation or the rules or the law, I should say, then that's how it's been for many years now. So this is why the public education becomes very, very, very important. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I've run into any number of people that think that I'm really telling a lie. Moss, you cannot be talking the truth, but these are facts. This is law.
I have some message came in that's unbelievable. So is that something that the industry, the association is looking or lobbying to change, or have you just settled and accepted that is what it is and we have to manage and work with what we have?
Oh, no, believe me, there's not a settling. I think that there's a sensitivity of due process, which I'm always an advocate for. It becomes worse in these times of high prices or inflationary impact on the industry. It becomes worse. It's bad to begin with in the sense that it's fixed. And so you have no way to adjust for cost of living, right? What is important to try to grasp is the only way that the gas stations can manage and keep on top of what they have to keep on top of and replenish fuel and that sort of stuff is really by the public patronizing the business, right? Mm-hmm. And so Keisha, you're one of my best customers when you let your car go to empty or hard on me to come.
Because my husband had that now.
Maybe I shouldn't let this kind of secret out, but it's really not a good practice in terms of what you end up paying for fuel. Because your car performs less efficiently, at least the gas performs less efficiently that way. So tell your dear husband, I'm a little bit in his corner, and I'm the worst person to be in that corner because I need you to come as frequently as possible. And not just me, but all of the retailers in general. But to the original question or disbelief expressed in the comment, yes, no matter what the price is, the retailers still only make 54 cents.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're going to come to some tips. We're coming to some tips of what we can learn and do as Bahamians, you know, like you say, what not to do, what to do. But we have another question that came in. How do oil prices affect gas prices, I would imagine, everywhere if there are alternate sources? Any thoughts on that?
Can you just repeat the question? I'm not quite sure I get the question.
So how do oil prices affect everywhere if there are alternate sources? And I guess what I get from this question is, if there are alternate sources that's coming, that the vendors globally, how does one, like, for example, the war in Ukraine, that's one source. There are other sources of oil and gas. How does that one source cause the prices everywhere to change?
As I understand it, and again, I can't speak as an expert in this area, mm-hmm. Because retailing has really just been my focus. But as I understand it, there's something called OPEC. And so countries that produce oil, and oil once it's refined, has a lot of byproducts. The car that you drive on in the streets comes from oil. Plastic comes from oil. So oil, one time ago, it used to be called black gold. Mm. And there's a lot of discussion in the various mediums around the world about this, you know, this product, good and bad. But once those who control the supply of oil, once that decision is made, the price is what it is, influenced by what is often said, supply and demand.
Right.
Which is a common economic expression that we really have to come to grips with. In other words, when the demand surges, you have a tendency to have prices that go up. When supply is challenged, prices go up because investors and those who own the product will begin to bid to purchase it, and it goes to the highest bidder. And then those who purchase the oil for the oil products, like gasoline, like diesel, to distribute it, depending on where the price is at the time they have to purchase, that is what ends up being the base of the final cost to consumers. So how does it happen? It's very, I don't know if it's complicated, but it's a system in the global environment that has a lot of history behind it. It's such an essential product in every jurisdiction in the world that it's managed globally. But again, like I said, that macro management has personal impact on you and I in our wallets. So, you know, transportation fueled by oil-based products is really going to be impacted when we have those sort of scenarios that are happening in Ukraine right now.
All right, that's very helpful. I see Patrick says, when there's a shortage of rumors of an upcoming shortage, here comes inflation. Absolutely. And that leads to another question that I was reading on in this Forbes article. Again, it was really talking about the impact of travel, but in the article it talked about the other areas that are very, what they're calling very energy intensive. And of course, aviation, which is travel, transportation, but also food and beverage, shipping, of course, which is a transportation heavy, agriculture. My sheet wasn't pulling up the others, but in essence, what we are talking about, the gas prices and the price at the pump. But can you share some insight into how the prices are also being shown in the restaurants and on in the other industries? And that's where we talk about, of course, inflation, cost of living going up, because that oil price is also affecting all of the other industries that are relying on oil or gas or energy.
Yeah. Keisha, I think you said it perfectly, you know. Whatever is an input cost to a final product that we consume, whatever impacts that input cost, it's what's going to impact you when you go to purchase it to consume it.
Mm-hmm.
In restaurants, you have supplies of food. That supply of food comes into our country mostly by ship. Ships use tons and tons of petroleum-based products or oil-based products. So fuel cost goes up, the shipping rate goes up, the taxes on the back of that will be inflationary as well. So by the time you sit down to have a meal in the restaurant, go to the food store to purchase supplies for your home, go to the stationery store to get books and pencils for your children and this sort of stuff, there, whatever the input to producing that end product that you're consuming, whenever that input is impacted, your end product is impacted. Mm-hmm. So I think it really is an eye-opening and pocket-felt experience for us where we don't control the supply chains. Wow. There have been any number of shows to talk about the natural resources that we have. At this current moment, we import literally everything we consume. Mm-hmm. So we will be impacted.
I am not managing and looking at the time, and I want to get to some tips. Tips on how, you know, like you said, certain things we can do at the pump to improve that factor, but also tips because you do have a financial background. You are an accountant by profession. So what can we do also from that standpoint, perhaps, that you may want to share? But there's a question that was in this article, and they answered the question in the article, but I'm going to ask it anyway, because you are in the industry and you may not have the answer to this, but the question is, how high will prices actually go in 2022? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, that's way above my pay grade. I hope I don't have to think about it, to be honest with you, but the reality is it's upon us. I think one of our government officials has been quoted as referring to prices as high as $8 a gallon. I must tell you, I hope that Jesus never materializes. I don't even want to repeat that, to be honest with you. Mm. Because, however, we have very little control over it. I would go so far as to say the government has very little control over it. Because, again, we're not suppliers of petroleum and petroleum-based products. Mm-hmm. So the tip that I would give in this instance, not trying to evade the question, but I really don't know. But the tip that I would give is really a tip that's found in and principle and grounded. You just have to manage what little you have. And, you know, that's tough to say.
Yeah.
But I think we have to say that because it could get worse before it gets better.
Yeah. And interestingly enough, the article actually said, and of course they were speaking from the U.S. standpoint, but, you know, in answer to the question in the article, it says much higher. And it's not because, of course, we know what we feel is driving it right now. And the article says it's not all Russia's fault. Energy prices were trending higher as COVID started to fade away. But Russia's military action made the made a bad situation worse. And so, you know, as you say, it's really just managing what little we have. I love this is something I had shared last week when we were talking about making more money, which is the other end of the spectrum. How could we, as people, as Bahamians, really look to increasing our salary while we are managing what we have? And I love this mindset. And it may be even hypothetical, but I love it anyway. It says, I don't care if gas becomes $6 a teaspoon, which is really high. I will have it to fill my tank. And I bring that up because you are, I don't know how many people know this, but you are classified as a Kingdom businessman, right? You are heavily in the Kingdom. You and I worked together on in an organization called the Kingdom Business Empowerment Network at BFM. And so you understand the Kingdom and you understand, you know, the scripture perhaps that my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. What would you say in terms of, you know, the angle of managing what we have? Because, of course, there is that message of management as well. But to the mindset of, hey, you know what? Perhaps I need to be doing, taking actions to increase my income, increase my business, or get into business. Or, you know, let's be real. What if your employees come to you and say, hey, we need more money as well? What are your thoughts from that standpoint in terms of how we should be thinking as these prices rise?
Keisha, I appreciate the question, and I must tell you, this statement of management really should not be taken lightly. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, speaking about kingdom, it is really one of the fundamental principles in the Word of God in the very beginning book. And in all aspects of our lives, and I'm not pointing fingers at anybody because I have to be conscious of this myself, what we don't manage, we lose.
Right.
And so when there's this tightening and scarce resources, I, for instance, share with my team members and colleagues who will listen to me, you know, management is a business term for a very principal concept, a very kingdom, deeply kingdom concept called stewardship. Mm-hmm. And stewardship doesn't mean just to take care of what you have. Stewardship means take care of it, but also to increase it. And how you increase it is where we have to use our creativity. It's what I've seen a number of people through the crises we have come through, the crises we're going through now. I was so excited to see our young people just doing things differently, considering the times that we're in. Going after opening those various businesses that they've opened and trying things from home or using their hands a bit more, which just builds the industry in the country. Now, maybe all of them weren't successful, but right. I tell you what, if our industriousness factor as a community, as a country grows, I think we'll be the better for it in the long run. One of the things about stewardship or management, as we frame it, is that if we're not careful to manage the little that we have, that little will end up being taken by somebody who managed the little that they have.
Mm-hmm.
And the worst thing that we can do, the worst thing in my humble view, and if you're listening audience, if I could leave this with you today, if nothing else, the worst thing in the world that we can do is become jealous, become stingy, not be creative, not think about goodness. Where is the niche that I can move into? Mm-hmm. What is this new order of things? It created some problems. How do I solve those problems and create a win-win business out of it? So that we can continue to perpetuate ourselves as a community. Other than that, your heart will fail you.
Right.
What will I do? Where will I turn? The government needs to help me. And those things are legitimate questions and positions to take. But we have to do our best to get creative, put thought to what we're doing. And for goodness sake, I hope, again, another thing that is transferred to the audience today, always count the cost of whatever it is you're about to do.
As a caveat,
many of us do things, start a business, and we didn't do the right kind of research and understand the parameters. But because somebody else is doing it, we jump into it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we don't count the cost until we have no choice but to count it, and it becomes a very difficult situation. So counting the cost, for instance, if I use this very same industry, I remember getting started, spending a lot of time with my colleagues who were as integral as I was in getting JML off the ground. We spent a lot of time looking at various scenarios and models, understanding what are the true costs in the industry, what is the industry really returning as a return on your investment? And then we had to make a decision whether that was enough for us to do what we wanted to do, and we did. And I thank God that we did. But before we got started, it took at least I almost want to say a year, because it may have been a full year of just investigating the cost, the true cost of doing business. So if you want to sell cake from you're great at baking, you want to sell cake from your home on the inside, but you never factor in your the value of your time in baking those cakes, then you're going to get disappointed on the other end. And all that time, all that energy you put into baking that cake and selling it, maybe you sold 100 and you made $2 at the end of the day because you didn't factor in your something as simple as your the cost of your time. You didn't do a good job in counting the cost. I don't want to ramble too much, but we can't get faint at heart because we're in a crisis because it's temporary.
Right. Yeah. I love what you said. If we don't manage, what we don't manage, we lose. And I love that. I mean, I've heard it many different ways, but I love that, the simplicity of that statement. As you were talking, Ethan, something came up, and it's a pet peeve of mine. And I would love to hear your perspective on it from an employer standpoint now, right? So you talk about... Of course, everything is going up. We talk about the need to be creative and perhaps, you know, use your gifts, use your talents to generate more money. Of course, counting the cost comes with that. What I do outside of generally, I do a lot of business coaching. So I speak to people on a weekly basis, people who are employees who understand that they have to take things into their own hands. They don't want to, you know, rely solely on the government. They don't want to rely solely on their salary because they understand that that is not able to cover the increased cost. And they are taking the initiative to start their, you know, side hustle, as we may. And I have had more than one client who come back and say, hey, Keyshelle, I can't do this anymore because my employer is discouraging the fact that I'm starting a new side hustle. It's not affecting my performance on the job at all. It's not affecting my ability to work from the 9 to 5. But the mere fact that my employer knows that I am doing something on the side, they are discouraging it. What would you say to those employers who have employees that fall into that category? They want to do something, they want to be creative, they want to increase their salary, but their boss, their supervisor, their manager is saying, hey, no, you are a slave to this job from 9 to 5. That's all you do, and I don't want to see you competing with anything else. What are your thoughts there? And that's kind of, in a nutshell, what I've seen in some cases.
Giving general advice to that kind of very interesting question is it's difficult to do, mm-hmm. because quite often, at least I've been around long enough to understand that there are many sides to the same story.
Yes, absolutely.
But what I will tell you is I'll just go back to the comment that I made earlier. Kind of in the beginning of our discussion. To me, my approach is, you empower people. You, an empowered team member or employee, as we refer to them. I prefer a team member. An empowered team member who's being industrious. To me, my experience has been they've been a more productive team member. But what, as a people, we need to understand is that we have to be disciplined around the rules and regulations and submit to those rules and regulations, and where we want to ask for grace, do it in a way that's transparent.
Okay.
Because if you have access to a company vehicle, but you're using that company vehicle to deliver the cakes you baked the night before, that is not being fair to your employer. Mm-hmm. And that's the part of the conversation that we don't like to have.
Right.
Now, I say that to say, I don't think people really mean to be abusive, not in the majority of circumstances. I really don't think so. Abuse does happen. But what we find ourselves doing is taking advantage of unfairly. And we have to be honest about that narrative, come to grips with it, manage it properly, and we'll be okay. I have team members in my organization right now. I can think about 3 or 4 of them that are running their own businesses. Very productive, actually add value to some of the things that we're doing. But one of the things that they do is they come to me for business, for guidance. They come to me and they'll ask, is it okay if I, would you support me in this area? Mm. And we've been able to really be proud of them and see the changes that they're making in their own life. But it's not easy to be this, can I say accommodating? Mm-hmm. If you get blindsided as an employer, if there's abuse, mm-hmm. And those are the things that we unfortunately are not honest enough about. Because if we are, I think we can go some places in this country.
Okay, that's clear. That's clear. What I'm hearing is that employee who is empowered or want to empower themselves to go to that person, their boss, their manager, the supervisor, and say, in upfront, be transparent, mm-hmm. with the hopes that action of going to their supervisor, being upfront, leads to a positive response. And generally, I pray it leads to a positive response as well. I mean, because like I said, I've been a part of some stories where that may have happened and the response was still no, you know. So, but, you know, that's a whole other conversation for a whole other time.
And that's why I say to answer it generally, yeah. It's kind of a tough call, yeah. because... Mm-hmm. There are circumstances that some employees try to compete with the employer.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So many factors.
And then there are some employers who, you know, they just don't get it. If you're going to be out there doing your stuff, you're going to come to work tired. If you come to work tired, you can take longer breaks. You're not going to focus. You're going to make mistakes, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And so I believe we shouldn't. We shouldn't say no, and we shouldn't say yes unless there's a meeting of the minds and discussion. How will this work?
Understood.
Can I hold you accountable to? You can't expect to be on a shift and call and say, oh, goodness, I ran in late because I went to a client. And,
right.
And you've got to consider those who worked the shift before you, right?
Yeah.
So it's not an easy answer,
right.
But I do believe that there are some synergies that can be achieved. If the attitude is, let me invest in my people. If the attitude is, let me be fair and just with my employer, I believe that there's some things that can be achieved. And really, frankly, we need to do it in our country because those getting started in business, they need the mentoring, they need the guidance. And those of us who've been in business for a while, we need the fresh input of creativity with ideas, with niche market development, because at the end of the day, all of these things can work together to build our country.
Yeah, and I love that. And I think that's where I wanted that answer. You know, if I had a wish to go, it's just helping business owners, employers like yourself, to see the value in it and not see it as a threat. But I do agree, it's no one size fit all. It's having a conversation with that employee, employer, and coming to some level of accountability. I love that. We have a call? No? Break? Yes, break. So let's go to the break. After the break, Ethan, I want to end in the last segment. Just again, you shared some tips, but some gas-related tips. You talk about, you know, how you love people like me who like to go on E, but there's some things that perhaps we need to know at the pump that may help us save in that way as well.
We know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity.
dad got prostate cancer. My family didn't know if I was going to live at Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number. They see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. That's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
The Water and Sewage Corporation advises its customers in New Providence and the Family Islands that the corporation will commence mass disconnections beginning Monday, March 28, 2022, on all outstanding accounts and financial agreements. Customers who have not honored their financial agreements are advised to visit their local offices to update those agreements as soon as possible. And all customers are further advised to bring their accounts up to date to avoid the disconnection of their water and sewage services without further notice.
Here we go.
J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents are the best. Reliable service, we've been on the scene, protecting since 1919.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
You know I was bigger when I come to you, you gave me food.
And welcome back. So I was paying attention this time. I wasn't letting the music, although I wanted to hear that song. Welcome back to the Hit Back. We are in our final segment of this show, and this show was entitled Inside the Industry, and we took a deeper look inside the oil and gas industry with our fabulous guest. It's such an interesting conversation. Ethan Moss, owner, founder of JML Enterprises, which heads or runs several of the retail gas station locations here in the country. And there's so much rich information. I want to take this final segment, and to me the segment is going to go by so fast, to talk about some tips. And so I just did a quick Google search, and it says, you know, here are some tips to save money on fuel. And I'll read a couple of them. And then, Ethan, if there's anything that you want to add as far as tips from your insider knowledge, let me know. The first one that came to mind is air up, and this is such a useful tip. Make sure that there is enough air in the tires. Underinflated tires create more rolling resistance with the pavement, thereby reducing gas mileage. Inflate your tires to the pressure recommended on the inside of your driver's side door. Check them periodically, and typically your gas mileage is going to be impacted by about 5% to 10% if you don't have proper inflation. Really, really good point. I had to remind myself of that this past week. My tires definitely could have been aired up, as this article says, and it does affect. Another tip that came is maintenance. Properly maintain your vehicle. Follow the manufacturer's recommendations for oil and other fluid changes and for replacing air and other filters. So make sure your car is well taken care of, because it does affect.
Keisha, can I just in?
Please jump right in.
Can I just endorse both of those things?
Mm-hmm.
You know, help the gas station, the retailers to help you, when you go to air up, and try not to destroy the apparatus to deliver the air. And you know, just place it back on the hooks or where it's to go. And that's because it's such an important thing in helping your car, your vehicle, to be efficient in its burn rate of the fuel. So, those two tips that you've given so far are really, really, really important.
Mm-hmm.
Service your vehicle sometime. And you know, I hope I don't get in problems with saying this.
Mm-mm.
It's very important also to look at the proper grade of oil for your particular engine. Historically, and I'm not sure too much now, but historically we had this thing in our head, if the oil is thick, then it'll stop your engine from getting destroyed. Actually, if you don't have the right grade of oil in your vehicle, and you should look on your vehicle or ask the mechanic to show it to you so you know when you go to the gas station which type to get, you could be burning lots and lots of gas unnecessarily. For instance, just as an example, the oil grading would say something like 5W20 or some number like that, or 10W30. The feeling the oil thick does not speak to the viscosity of the oil, which is the measure for what is necessary for the vehicle that you drive. And particularly with newer vehicles, right? You talk, they're very specific about what type of oil to put into your vehicle. And so pay attention to that. And of course, service your vehicles. If you have dirty air filters, you know, it's the burn rate is going to be impacted because it's not firing the way it needs to fire. Mm-hmm. So great tips.
Yeah, and I'm happy that you jumped in because, you know, one of the pet peeves, I would imagine, is, you know, you're getting, going to the gas station to get your air up and the, you know, the air area is down. And I love that message to us as drivers to, you know, take care of it because we need it. We need it to ensure that the gas in our car also lasts a little bit longer. I love that.
Great.
There is, go on.
Maybe you have this, but it's one we were speaking to earlier as well. Mm-hmm. You know, do the best that you can. And again, I hope I don't get in problems with my colleagues in the industry. Mm-hmm. But do the best.
Well, we want the secrets.
To kind of keep your vehicle. Don't let it run empty.
Oh Lord.
Try to keep your vehicle. I would say at least half tank, and if you have a full tank, that's even better. You read the average purchase of gasoline, I think you read that earlier, mm-hmm. in our country, somewhere between $10 and $15. And that means if you're doing a lot of runs, you're going to the gas station frequently,
yes.
Especially today, because, you know, if you're putting $10 gas in your car, you're not even getting 2 gallons worth of fuel.
Mm-hmm.
And we've become accustomed not ordering by gallons, but by ordering with what in our purse or pocketbook or in wallet.
Mm-hmm.
I got $20. That's all I can afford.
That's all I got.
Right. So the retailers are really your friends. That's I think ultimately that's the message what I want to convey. We are really keen on being an integral part of building a community. We know we deliver an essential service or product to the community, and we can't do this without you. So help us to help you. And if you keep the air in your tires, if you service your vehicles on time, use the right grading of oil in your vehicles, if you try to keep your tanks as full as you can, you know, try not to let it get less than half tank and then go and redo it, I think you'll see an improvement in your vehicle. One of the things that I wish the listening audience would help us with is, if your car isn't empty and you put $5 gas in, please don't drive down the road and say the gas didn't go in.
Oh, Jesus.
because the young men and women on the forecourts, you know, they don't quite know how to tell you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you didn't really get a gallon of gasoline. It's not going to move your needle, so to speak.
Yeah,
anyhow, I don't want to get into
that kind of stuff. That's good. I think that's so good because, again, it's the information, right, and the insights that we as drivers, perhaps, or motorists tend to forget. I remember going, of course, to one of your locations, and I thought it was such helpful that, again, I'm the same. Yeah, if I have $20 is usually the minimum I would put because typically I'll have a 20 and I'll say, hey, I have 20 because I got to go back to the gas station a couple of days anyway. And I thought it was a very useful tip that one of your team members said. And she was like, you have a dollar something more because that'll give you 2 solid gallons or whatever she said. This was some time back. And I was so grateful for that. And I did have, you know, a dollar and some or whatever amount it was. Because she was thinking like, okay, you know what? You only need a couple more dollars to get a full gallon. And I thought that was a very useful tip. And so I would love to see more of that at the gas, from the team members at the gas station. And sometimes perhaps that's not their job, but I thought that was a very useful tip. And then to your point, if you know you come empty and you only want $5, should or could the team member say, you know, you sure you won't put $10 in that to get you to a gallon? Should that be the conversation? Because some people just don't know. Like me, I just put gas in the car. I don't watch the prices per se. What are your thoughts there?
Yeah, it could be offensive if you tell somebody you sure you don't put more gas in, right? So we have to be very careful not to offend our customers. Mm-hmm, but there's a good number of our team members who have learned and used that to upsell the customer. Right. But most importantly, so that the customer understands that really, if your car takes 12, 16 gallons or 8 gallons of fuel, and you're only putting in a gallon, you're not going to get the burn. You're not going to be able to use that gallon, but it's your hard-earned money. We mm-hmm. appreciate that. So that's why we try to do the things or give you the tips in the moment. It gets busy at gas stations sometimes, so it's a little difficult to always be consistent in that. But trust you, me. My colleagues are listening. We know what our marching orders are because we need the public, and we'll do our best to help our team members to make sure I educate you as well.
Yeah, no, I love that. I was so grateful to her when she did that. And again, I frequent, again, certain gas stations, so they know Keyshell, they know Miss Davis. Sometimes I get a nice big hail, and if they don't hail me, I'm like, you, I know your boss, so you better treat me right. But it's something that I do appreciate. Oh, I did appreciate, and I would love to see more. I have a text message that came in. My husband is a chief mechanic, and he frequently tells me not to let my car go empty because it drags up all of the debris at the bottom of the gas tank, and it mixes it into the actual gas, which will eventually cause problems with the engine. Good point. Any thoughts, Ethan?
Well, yeah. Again, maintenance is very important. Like everything that we use in terms of equipment, vehicles, over time, you will have issues with your tanks, et cetera.
Right.
And gasoline and diesel, these are products that over time, if you don't maintain the equipment, you can have some significant issues. So, yes, you can go into a gas station and buy gas treatment occasionally to treat the product that's in your tank or at the bottom of your tanks, but the real key is not to let your car go empty.
Oh, Lord, I am converted, okay? I think it's knowledge, too. Because, again, to me, cars are meant to, this is my ignorance now, the tank is meant to go empty, and when it's empty, you just fill it up. But, again, it goes back to that knowledge of, you know, why shouldn't you allow it to go empty? And the fact that you fill it at when the gas is at half gives you more efficiency with the fuel. And so, again, I like these little tips that I'm gathering from these conversations or from these messages because it really is helpful. And I think a lot of people, some people don't necessarily take the time to think about it. They just, again, pull up and say $20 or $50, $100 on pump 7.
So let me give you a joke, right? We eat food, Keyshell, because we want to make sure we keep our energy going and we want to be efficient mm-hmm. and not fall out from what Bahamians would call catching gas, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So if you let your body go empty and you catch gas, it becomes more difficult to be efficient. So like your car, don't let your car go empty because it'll suck up all of that stuff. But, like the caller said, at the bottom of your tank, and it can get in your injectors and make the firing or the fuel efficiency go down, and then you end up spending more money, and you could have additional costs in maintaining your vehicle. So you really must take care of your vehicles.
Yeah.
Do the best that you can. It's not an inexpensive thing. But if you want to save in gasoline and diesel for sure, please maintain them.
I love that. And again, it's that good reminder. We have a couple more minutes and we have one more text and continue to text, but we have a text that came in. And then Ethan, after you answer this, feel free to share based on the full conversation that we've had, any final thoughts that you want to give to the listeners based on what we talked about. So this question was, what does your guest think about eco mode in your car?
Okay, eco mode sounds as though that's referring to an electric vehicle. Mm-hmm. If it is in gasoline vehicles, I'm just not aware. And I think what that does is it allows your car to be efficient and not burn if it's gasoline. Again, I'm not sure if there's eco in gasoline, but certainly in electric vehicles. So that you won't use all your battery power for certain things. So eco mode, use it. It can only help you in terms of the consumption of either the electricity or the gasoline. So my final words to the listeners, because this show is about trying to understand the inside of the industry. I think fundamentally, if there's one thing I want to convey to your listeners, it's that our country, we will be impacted by the things that are happening globally because we import those things that are supplied to our country. So we have to manage. We have to manage. We have to manage. And management means, yes, take care of what you have. Yes, that which you have, find ways to increase it. And yes, you have to be aware of the things that will impact the very dollars that you work so hard for. So my encouragement is, those who are going in business, get mentoring. Those who are managing their tight budgets, manage your tight budgets. And listen to shows like this that brings you information to help you along the way.
Thank you so much, Ethan. I hear the music, and so we are going to wrap up. It's been a pleasure hosting this show again, The Hit Back. My name is Keyshell Davis. Just one final comment. I have to end with this, producer. She says, she pulled up to Rubis and rounded off my purchase up to the penny. She asked for 8 gallons at $44.15. I am going to do that next time. I'm going to ask for a certain number of gallons to the penny. And so I thought that was a nice way to end. It's been a pleasure again. Have a fabulous Thursday, and I will see you next week Thursday on The Hit Back.
She like Alamantin. Tell me it's the fish fry. We eat at 100. She know I'm a Bahamian. From the Bahamas, it's the place you vacation.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.